So we start our session, and this is about move nigra. Okay, thank you. Now this is about the clinical radiological correlation in neuro-ophthalmological cases. So it's very important to know the neuroanatomy of that area. And we know that by the symptomatology of the patient, what area we would be dealing with, and to what lesion would be there according to the history and clinical examination. And then we have to verify the lesion by our neuroimaging. So we need to know a proper imaging which we want to get at that site, and final section need to be asked. So clinical examination is still superior. And in collaboration, in both like clinical examination, the neuroimaging and neuroanatomy of that area, we could give a proper clinical diagnosis to the patient. So now I start with the first case. This is about a 55-year-old male patient who came to us with a history of gradual decrease in vision in the both eye. So there was a simultaneous loss of vision in both the eye. It was over a period of 2 years. And he also gave a history of off and on headache for 2 years. This headache used to be very mild and it's bitemporal area. So by the history, and a month back, he had a severe headache. And following that, he started observing the wobbling of the objects. So this, by the symptomatology of the patient, there's a gradual loss of vision, both the eyes simultaneously associated with the headache. Definitely we will keep in our mind, it is an intracranial pathology, because visual loss associated with headache leads to intracranial pathology. Secondly, there's a bilateral simultaneous loss of vision that suggests it must be a midline lesion, which is compressing both our visual pathways. And the structure would be a cellular mass, which will compressing the chiasma, which is a midline structure, and results into the visual loss in the both eye. Secondly, we know the chest chiasmal compression, there's a hemianopia, the visual loss would not be there because the half of the macula is enough to give 6x6 vision. And the patient usually complains of the field defect, but this has a visual decrease in the visual vision, most probably because along with the chiasmal compression, it must be extending anteriorly, also compressing the intracranial part of the optic nerve, resulting in the visual loss also. The headache, all you know, cellular mass stretches the diaphragma cellae and causes the headache. And it's usually bitemporal because the V1 nerve, which is the referred area of the V1 nerve. He had a sudden onset of headache, which was very severe. And following that, he had an additional feature, neurological feature, neuro-ophthalmic feature, like wobbling of the object, moving of the object. That suggests, to begin with, it's a 2 years history. That means it's a slowly growing lesion. That means definitely must be a compressive lesion. But sudden onset of new neurological sign and symptom suggests there is a sudden increase in the size of the tumor. And we know it's a pituitary apoplexy is a very common feature which presents with a severe headache and sudden onset of the neurological symptoms. So now we have a patient who had a gradual decrease of vision along with the ocular movements problem. When we examine the patient, acuity best corrected was 612, 618 in the eye. The ocular motility was normal in all directions, but he has a seesaw nystagmus. Can you play the video? वीडियो नहीं प्ले हो पाना है ये है इट्स वीडियो ओनली तो फिर ना सो क्लिक करियो
Actually, there is a video of that seesaw nystagmus. That is what we just want to show you. And it is very interesting, definitely.
How do you just use a play card? उसको प्ले कर दो फिर मैं बंद कर दूँगी बहुत उठ
जाएगा.
सो इफ़ यू कैन ऑब्जर्व इन द वीडियो देर इज़ अ वर्टिकल डिसकंजुगेट मूवमेंट ऑफ द आई विद अ कंजुगेट टॉर्शन ऑफ द आईज. द आई विच गोज अप इन टॉट एंड द विच गोज डाउन एक्सटॉट एंड दिस मूवमेंट दे डिक्रीज इन द पेशेंट इज मूविंग इट्स आईज इन द डिफरेंट डायरेक्शन. So this is the pendular seesaw nystagmus. So seesaw nystagmus can be a pendular or a jerky. The pendular seesaw nystagmus suggests to an extrinsic compression of the mesodiaphyseal lesion, while the intrinsic suggests that the midbrain a jerky seesaw nystagmus suggests an intrinsic midbrain lesion. So this patient has a pendular nystagmus suggests there is a compression of mesodiaphyseal junction by the extrinsic lesion. The pupil where sluggish reaction, the fundus or bilateral temporal dyspallor. The field suggests bitemporal hemianopia, which suggests definitely there is a salar mass, which was compressing the chiasma. And there was a long seesaw nystagmus suggests there must be a brainstem compression along with that. So when we got the definitely in any intracranial pathology, we have to get neuroimaging done. The MRI revealed a very giant pituitary adenoma, which was not only extending suprasalary and parasalary area, was extending retrosalary and compressing into the interpeduncular fossa, causing splaying of the pedicle. So this is the coronal section. The arrow shows lifting of the optic chiasma. It was quite a huge lesion. And when you see, this is the axial section, and you can appreciate that the lesion was extending retrosalary and into the both of the in the interpeduncular fossa, splaying both of the cerebral peduncle, and that is the result. That is the cause of seesaw nystagmus in this patient. So when we by how to explain this why it's displaying that chiasmal compression with the visual loss and seesaw nystagmus in this patient, we can explain by this pathology, by this explaining the pathway which was compressed by this lesion, which was extending into the retrobulbar area, into the retrochiasmal area and into the interpeduncular fossa, splaying the cerebral peduncle. If you see in the diagram, there's a compression of disturbance of the accessory optic pathway. We know there is a medial transit tegmental nuclei which is, has an inhibitory influence on the interstitial nucleus of Cajal and the vestibular nuclei. Once, because of the compression of this medial tegmental nuclei by the interpeduncular extension of the lesion, it disturbs this connection to the vestibular nuclei indirectly through the inferior olivary nucleus and to the interstitial nucleus of Cajal, resulting into the seesaw nystagmus. And this our lesion was also present in this area, which I showed diagrammatically. So it's not a very common finding to get a seesaw nystagmus in the salar lesion, in the pituitary adenoma cases. When you do get, then you think of, okay, this must be a very large lesion, not only causing compression chiasma, it must be extending retrosalarly and compressing the prostral part of the midbrain, hence needs an early surgery. Now case two is about a 45-year-old male patient who presented with complaint of sudden onset of headache, with sudden onset of some disturbance in the right side of the visual field. In fact, he was not clearly citing the field defect, but he said there's some problem in the right side of his visual field. And as both these symptoms are sudden in onset, so hence it's suggestive of some ischemic or a vascular pathology must be there. And this patient also gave a history. He used to see the form visual hallucination and persistence of the image. form visual hallucination, we always have some motion in them. Like he would see some building is moving, coming towards him, or the cars are moving in different direction. The glasses are also flying over there, and the dogs are running in the street. So always whatever hallucination he was getting, it has a motion in that. And persistence of image, palinopsia. So whenever he would, it was a persistence of the after image of the object which he had looked at previously. He was looking at something and then he shifted his gaze to the other. It will over the previous object's image would overlap on the object which he would be looking at recently. So that was a palinopsia. It was bothersome to him. So when he examined, the neuro-ophthalmic examination was normal, except there was a field defect, which was a right homonymous hemianopia. But it was surprising more in the inferior quadrant and less extending in the superior quadrant. So we, as is a young patient with a stroke, then we investigated the patient for the causes of the stroke, like hemogram was normal, biochemistry was normal, coagulation profile was normal, vasculitis was normal, homocystinuria was normal. But he had, at the time when he came to us, he was found to have a high blood pressure. Though he didn't have it was not a known case of hypertension. The MRI of the patient revealed, this is a DWI imaging, which is very good for detecting the infarct in the early stage. And you can see there was an acute infarct in the right, quite extensive, right parieto-occipital and temporal area. This infarct was mainly involving the parietal area, and probably that was the edema which was extending on the temporal lobe, because of a field effect was more localized to the inferior quadrant of the visual field. So this is the extension of the, this is the involvement of the temporal lobe, which was giving the form visual hallucination. And the motion was there because we know this is a temporoparieto-occipital junction, which is mainly responsible for interpretation or perception of the motion of an object. So it won well not this area resulted in the form visual hallucination with a motion in characteristic to that. Definitely when there's an infarct, we always get the angiogram done, which was perfectly normal in this patient. And when we look at the neuroanatomy of that side, we know from the V1 area of a visual cortex, the pathway divided into two. One is the dorsal parallel pathway, one the dorsal and the ventral. The dorsal goes into the parietal lobe, and it's mainly the Weir pathway, where we localize the lesions, where it is, like orientations. And the inferior one, which goes to the temporal, is mainly Ward pathway, which helps in the recognition of the object. And the damage, infarct of this region results into the palinopsia or prosopagnosia, which was not in our patient. So the inability to identify, though the visual acuity will be normal, but the patient would not be able to identify his relatives' faces also. So this patient has a palinopsia, but as we know, this is the area of the parieto-occipital temporal area mainly responsible for motion perception. The form visual hallucination, we are having the motion characteristic. And unformed, we know it's mainly the occipital cortex involvement. So whenever you get a patient with field defect and the form visual hallucination, then think of the lesion will be in the parieto, it is in the temporal cortex also. So that shows the area where which is involved. The case 3 is about a 55 years of male patient. He was a known hypertensive patient. He came to us with a history of mild headache. And there was a transient obscuration of vision lasting for seconds. But he was very much persistent about that he had a severe pain on the right side of the neck. And this was for 1 month. In fact, headache was bad, but he was much more bothered about that pain on the right side of the neck along the sternocleidomastoid muscle and transient obscuration of the vision. He gave a history of an infective pathology in the external ear a month back, and following that, the symptomatology appeared. Examination, acuity, and motility in people were normal, but the fundus shows grade 4 papilledema, both the eyes, and there was tenderness along the medial aspect of sternocleidomastoid muscle on the right side. Rest of the systemic and neurological examination was normal. So this is a patient who has a features of increased intracranial pressure in the form of headache, transient obscuration of vision, and papilledema. without any focal neurological sign and symptom. So we will make a clinical diagnosis of benign intracranial hypertension. Now we have to confirm that whether it is a benign intracranial hypertension or not. Neuroimaging would be the first modality to be done. So when we MRI is done, we ordered, and it's very important when you are making a diagnosis of benign intracranial hypertension, you ask for not a plain MRI with contrast, MRA and MRV, and MRV just not MRV, MRV with contrast. Because sometimes you just write MRV, they do the time of flight imaging, where you can miss this small thrombus or narrowing the venous sinuses. So we got the MRI and MRV with the contrast, and what we found out, this is again a flare imaging, and what we found out, there was a big thrombus in the right lateral sinus, sigmoid sinus, and it was extending to the proximal part of the internal jugular vein. And because it was the right venous sinus thrombosis, the patient was very much symptomatic. If the similar features had been on the left, the patient might not be so much symptomatic. As we know, the left tarsal sinus doesn't take part much in the venous drainage of the intracranial venous drainage. The right, which is a dominant venous sinus, and mainly drains venous blood into the heart from the brain. So it was the right transverse venous sinus thrombosis, which was extending the sigmoid sinus and into the proximal part of the internal jugular vein. Definitely, the thrombosis of the lateral sinus sigmoid was result into the headache because of the stretching of the meninges and all. But the pain in the neck was because of the extension of the thrombus in the proximal part of the internal jugular vein. So it's important to notice whatever, to take into account whatever the symptoms patient sees, because sometimes may lead into the diagnosis to us. Because as he was saying that it was pain over there, that area in the internal jugular vein, we will think it might, BIH might be because of the venous sinus thrombosis. So when we investigated it, we didn't find any cause for coagulation, but might be a pathology, infective pathology, the ear with the middle ear infection, which we know the middle ear is very much in close proximity to the transverse sinus, and that it must have caused infection might have extended to the sinus, resulting thrombosis. So when I went back to the Walsh and Hoyt, I've seen this is the classical sign which is described, and that whenever the thrombus or lateral sinus extend to the proximal part of the internal carotid artery, the patient along with headache and the features of increased intracranial pressure may complain of the pain on the along the medial side of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So that is an important sign and the thing which we should remember in our mind. So this is the venous sinuses. We all know about the connection and the how it drains, and it's very important because thrombosis or a hypertrophic arachnoid granulation or narrowing of the sinus, mainly the dominant sinus, right sinus, definitely results into the acute and the marked rise in ICP, because main drainage of CSF occurred by the arachnoid granulation which are present in the venous sinus. So any pathology in the dominant venous sinus results into acute and marked increase in the ICP with the very rapid decrease in the vision, hence and very gross papilledema. Hence, it's very important to recognize the venous sinus pathology early. And when you suspect this is the patient with just raised intracranial pressure, BIH case, and always ask for MRV. This is another young female who came to us with a complaint of double vision and headache. But she was non-hypertensive, non-diabetic, and didn't have any systemic disease. When we examined, the vision was normal, but the near vision was defective in the right eye, that is accommodative failure was also there in the right eye. On examination, we know definitely that the third nerve pathology we are dealing with, and there was R over L, which increases on the right in the abduction of that eye, and the left opposite side head tilt, which suggests of inferior rectus palsy. The pupil of that side was, as there was a pupillomotor paralysis also there, so it was larger in size than the left eye, and it was not reacting to the light in the near. So we have, these are the clinical photograph of the patient. If you can there see, there's a right R over L. You can see more sclera on the right side. And this was increasing when the patient was looking at the right side. And the rest of the fundus and the fields were normal. So if we make a clinical diagnosis of right inferior rectus palsy with minimal involvement of the right pupil. This type of clinical scenario we may get even there is a, either there is an orbital pathology, there only the segmentation of the nerve occurs in the superior and the inferior division, or there might be a midbrain pathology. It may midbrain pathology, it may be mainly because of we know there are different subnuclei of the third nerve. So any microvessel occlusion because of the hemorrhage, micro bleed, or a microvascular occlusion may result into the involvement of the subnucleus. So isolated muscle palsy is also a feature of midbrain lesion. So we, and she was a young patient, so we got the hemogram and vasculitis would be most probable cause because she was not a hypertensive and diabetic. So vasculitis is another cause of a stroke in the young, but she was normal. And the MRI revealed a ring enhancing lesion in the midbrain with perilesion edema. And our neuroradiologist is very neuroradiologist who was a very experienced. He said either it's a neurocystic sarcus or tuberculoma, but my neuroimaging features are more suggestive of tuberculoma. You go ahead with ATT treatment to this patient. So this is an axial MRI of this patient. You can appreciate a ring-enhancing lesion in the tegmental area of the midbrain, and it is near to the midline. And it is the area where the fascicles of the third nerve would be lying. Because we know the nucleus of the third nerve is in the perisylvian, aqueductal area, and it's more dorsal in the midbrain, and its lesion is much more in the tegmental area. It's in the more of the ventral part of the midbrain, and it's near to the midline where the fascicles of the third nerve lie. So we know the fascicles, and this is the we know by the imaging, the symptomatology of the our patient, that is the inferior rectus and the minimal pupil involvement, is because of this ring lying in enhancing lesion lying into the midbrain where the fascicles of third nerve lie. So the, by neuroimaging, we can explain our symptoms of this patient. And if we go to the neuroanatomy of that area, we all know the nuclei which lie in the ventral to the periaqueductal gray matter. And then the fibers, they run on the ventral side. And these are the fascicles which they fan out. And they extend rostral to the caudal direction and medial to the lateral direction. But there is a proper topographic arrangement of these fibers. And these the most medial are the papillary fiber, then inferior rectus fiber, then LPS, medial rectus, then superior rectus, and the lateral most of the inferior oblique fiber. So our lesion was much more near to the midline, where the fibers, the pupil and the inferior rectus are lying. That's why there was isolated involvement of both these structures. If we go back to the neuroimaging, the lesion is lying in the fascicular area near to the midline, where the fibers of the papillary and the inferior rectus muscle must be lying. And we can explain by neuroanatomy of that area why we had these isolated finding in this our patient. So we gave the patient ATT for a period of 2 years, and the patient's double vision pupillary asymmetry resolved, but there was still some accommodative failure which persisted. So there is a case of a tuberculoma of the brain presenting with isolated inferior rectus palsy with partial pupil involvement. So this type of scenario, we know this is a midbrain lesion, we can get this type of isolated involvement of the third, for isolated involvement of the oculomotor muscles. This is another interesting young patient who was a 14-year-old boy who complained he had only one attack of amaurosis foggax, like the transient blurring of vision in the right eye. There was no complete blackout, but there was transient blurring of the vision, 3 weeks period, and the transient period blurred vision persisted for a period of 5 months. That we know that must be ischemic. Ischemic lesion was results into ischemia will cause a 5 minute, amaurosis foggax will have a duration of 5 minutes, and he didn't have any other positive history which suggests us to explain this pathology. When his blood pressure was slightly asymmetric, it was not recordable in the right eye, even the pulse was very weak in the right eye, and the rest of the examination was normal. Neuro-ophthalmic examination was completely normal, including the fundus. There was no emboli, nothing we could find out. So may make a diagnosis of a young patient with one episode of amaurosis foggax and an absent pulse in the right pupil limb. Definitely, we make most, definitely the clinical possibility of Takayasu arthritis, which is a very common disease, which we get to see as an ophthalmologist. So when we, once you make a diagnosis of Takayasu, the next stage would be a CT and CT angio of the head and the neck area also. So when we got the CT of the head and CT angio of the head and the neck area, what we found out, these are the all blood investigation which were normal in this patient, because there was hemorrhagic fibrillation along with the neurological, cardiological cause has to be ruled out in a coagulation and vasculitis profile. They all were normal. The CT angio showed there was a focal narrowing of the subclavian artery, the post-cystinotic dilatation, and the distal to that, the artery was completely occluded. There were a lot of good collateral formation at that narrowing part, and there was a right cervical rip, which was causing compression of the subclavian artery, which we can see the radiologist again make the patient to move his hand up and took the photograph, and there was much more compression of the subclavian artery, and you can see there's very clearly the cervical rip is there, compressing the subclavian artery, narrowing, and after the narrowing there was a dilatation, post-cystinotic dilatation of the artery. Usually it should be a narrowing of the artery, but there's a post-cystinotic dilatation, which suggests there must be thrombus inside the artery. So now it is very difficult to explain that patient has a problem in subclavian artery narrowing and the post-cystinotic thrombosis in the artery. And why did he get the hemorrhagic fibrillation? Because subclavian artery doesn't participate in the supply blood supply to our eye. It is mainly the carotid circulation which takes part in the blood supply to the eye. So why does it happen? It can be explained. It can be explained the thrombus, it extended, this is a retrograde extension, retrograde embolism from the thrombus, from thrombus of the subclavian artery into the carotid circulation, and going from the subclavian artery thrombus, the embolism has gone into the retrograde direction to the carotid circulation, and it went into the eye and resulted in the hemorrhagic fibrillation. So we have to keep in mind that in the young patients, not only the coagulation, vasculitis, and Takayasu arthritis, sometimes the cervical rip may cause the compression of these blood vessels and may cause the retrograde embolization, and it can cause this hemorrhagic fibrillation. So this is a very uncommon presentation of this case. Now about this boy, who was a 20-year boy, complained of seeing a white bright light which was spinning into the one particular peripheral field of the vision, and this spinning white light had a zigzag edges, and it has a color also, which were the primary color. Sometimes they would look like blue, sometimes green, and sometimes red. And it was spinning at that area, it was not extending. And after some time, for a period of after a few seconds, it then spread into the whole visual field, and this was followed by a darkness of the field for a period of 5 minutes. That suggests us that this is a unformed visual hallucination, and it is mainly an ictal phenomena, because in ictal phenomena, wave of excitation followed by wave of depression. The wave of excitation resulted into the brightness of the whole visual field, and there was a wave of dark or depression which results into darkness. So this was such, and he didn't have any, his rest of the examination and history, that was perfectly normal. So we make a diagnosis, this is an irritative pathology of the visual cortex, because rest of the neurological examination was normal. And occipital area is the area which is a neurological silent, only whatever pathology is results into the visual symptoms. And it's mainly, these are the unformed visual hallucination, and which we're having, which didn't show any buildup phenomena or something, only at the time, at the end it spread to the whole field with followed by wave of depression, suggestive of the ictal phenomena. We make a diagnosis of occipital lobe seizure. And before making the occipital lobe, say we got the EEG, occipital lobe EEG, we did it from that surface electrode. Sometimes it's difficult to pick up the abnormal EEG signal when you do it EEG with the surface electrode. You have to do, to get a better EEG, you need a pin electrode to do it. Because we did it with the surface electrode, we found the EEG was normal. But definitely history-wise, it was the ictal phenomena because the irritation of the visual cortex. And rest of the examination was normal. Even the field was normal in this patient, though it was an occipital pathology, occipital ictal. So when we got the MRI done, what we found, there was an 8 millimeter ring enhancing lesion in the left medial parieto-occipital region. Why the field was normal in this patient? Because the lesion was quite anterior, because of the visual where might be temporal crescent would be lying. But as we don't go very, it was at the time we had a top cone perimeter and that to supra threshold, we could not find out temporal crescent loss. So we found that the field, we said it's normal. And it's a very anterior location of the lesion which causes the normal visual field in this patient. And on the further cut section of that CT, this shows that there was a perilesional edema which was extending into the occipital area also. So this is an occipital lobe seizure. And this ring enhancing lesion, according to neuroradiologists, is the neurocysticercus. So this is a case of isolated neurocysticercus sitting in the occipital area. And once it was degenerating, releasing the toxin, causing irritation of a visual cortex, resulting to the formation of unvisual, resulting into the symptoms of unformed visual hallucination. And it's an ictal phenomena because we know that light was colorful and it was spinning and localized, not showing a built-up or marching phenomena as we get in the migraine aura. So we gave the patient albendazole, visolone, and tegretol and for a period of 20 days. And after one course of this treatment, the patient became asymptomatic. And this follow-up CT also shows the resolution of the lesion. But we kept the tegretol for a period of 2 years to this patient. This is a patient who also had a similar presentation of unformed visual hallucination. And he also had a similar examination. And his imaging also showed a ring-enhancing lesion, which was, this is a T2 imaging. That's why we can't see properly the ring-enhancing lesion. There's an edema which we are appreciating in this patient. This, you can see there's a ring-enhancing lesion over here. And is a degenerating phase of the cysticercus and which was causing releasing the toxins that resulting to perilesion edema and which was responsible for this ictal phenomena. So occipital lobe seizure, this is another same case with the another case with the similar symptomatology with the isolated neurocysticercus and who also responded well on the albendazole and the tegretol treatment and visolone along with that. So we know the unformed visual hallucination is very typical of, earlier we had a patient of formed visual hallucination which was suggestive of temporal lobe lesion. And this is a patient who had an unformed visual hallucination because of the occipital lobe lesion. And it's important to get the EEG done to rule out any occipital lobe epilepsy in this patient. If EEG is normal, then get the imaging done to find out any ictal lesion over that occipital area. So this is a difference all we know with the formed and unformed visual hallucination. This is about a 50-year-old lady who was a postmenopausal lady. She also complained of the similar features, like in the complaint seeing a bright spinning light in the peripheral field of a bright spinning light, but that spinning light was mainly near to the area of fixation where she was looking at. And this light didn't have any colors. What the previous patient of the ictal visual hallucination the patient had, the different primary colors were there and it was, the slide was also spinning. It was very near to the fixation where of that central field, it was starting the central field. It had a zigzag like according to the patient and the zigzag like have a fortification like black and white lines. So it was very much typical and it was spreading gradually and lasted for a period of 5 minutes and it was spreading gradually and there was a built-up phenomena. And there was no other history of headache or nothing, but she used to get this type of attacks, visual hallucination attacks, like visual, these spinning lights she was seeing off and on for like few months. But she gave a past history of migraine at the young age. She used to get typical classical migraine attacks in the younger age. And she didn't have any other history which was suggestive of any other pathology. Examination was normal. Occipital lobe EEG was also normal. MRI was normal. So definitely it was not the ictal phenomena. It was definitely a case of acephalic migraine. And we could make a diagnosis of acephalic migraine is a postmenopausal age or the older age group. The headache phase is not there, only the aura phase is always there in these patients of the migraine. So this is a patient of acephalic migraine, and when we didn't treat the patient because she was not, she just wanted to have a diagnosis, or she wanted to, there is no other pathology, or if we want, you can give a topiramate to this patient. So gradually these attacks disappeared. So what is acephalic migraine? It's a migraine with aura, but there would not be any headache. It's relatively uncommon. We make the diagnosis when patient gives a history of a typical migraine attack in the younger age group. There may be other symptoms along with these lights, visual, perception of this light. Along there will be other features like nausea, photophobia, other features, but there would not be any headache. It is also called silent migraine. These are various features you can get in acephalic migraine without headache. And there are certain features will help us, whether it's an ictal visual hallucination or it is the part of an acephalic migraine. This visual hallucination is a part of a migraine, acephalic migraine. The ictal visual hallucination, they are short duration. They are always lasting for seconds. They are invariable. They are consistent. Always they appear in the same visual field and with the same shape or same characteristic, and they are colorful. They won't have a fortification, like their edges would be zigzag, but would not have a black and white lines, and would not show any marching or built-up phenomena. They appear usually in the peripheral field. And while the migraine, this visual hallucination or acephalic migraine aura only without any visual aura, without any headache, usually they are of a longer duration, minimum for 30 minutes, may up to the 1 hour. And they usually start near to the center field, and they start shows the marching or a built up phenomena, and will have a fortification spectrum, means that edge of the visual aura would, and the visual phenomena would be black and white zigzag and with a black and white line, while the center would be a depressed area, the dark area. So there is a positive phenomena and the negative visual phenomena both. So visual lesion can be featured occipital lobe lesion, and imaging should be done as I already told you. Because you